Right. Yeah. So we, as we always do, a few moments of preparation so we can get rid of the concerns of the day to attend to the words of our speaker and this topic, which is a very significant one. Your speaker galla hel gekindir, mer jog minni mer gehen dallar, elt kvöld til kvöld sinir, fyr not og nir, der røyde maug og mitt tog sinir og gevet sitt grunt om sykker. Brander af brandi brenn og spunin er, funni kvekest af funna masa af manni første af maug kyrse en til dalsker af dår. Flame is quickened by flame, a man from another man may become wiser, but from his own conceit may remain ignorant. Truth, like the sky, is above and beyond us all. Gods of our peoples and lands, may we spend this time together with you and with each other in friendship, and use it to the common good, with profit and with pleasure. Forgive me for speaking autobiographically in introducing this topic, which I think will speak of how two opposing traditions may thrive again in one coherent European civilization. When I realized I was someone of faith and not an atheist, and I wished to uphold the values of the culture I was born into, I joined the national church of my country, namely the Church of England. At the same time knowing, fully conscious that I didn't believe in the theology. If I recall, the main thing I had to say was, I turned to Christ, which I interpreted in a performative sense, that by joining the church, it was describing the act I was thereby performing. So it was true without any other propositional entailment. But Christianity does really require one to believe that because a historical charismatic Jewish leader was arrested and put to death by the Romans, one's sins are thereby vitiated and one's relation to the divine powers is transformed. Without the belief that Jesus is the supreme deity, sincere and satisfying worship is difficult. Therefore, I couldn't remain. I used to be angry that this religion had replaced what I thought of as my indigenous spiritual inheritance. And I used to be angry at my ancestors who had turned their backs on the gods. But now I'm much more accusing of myself. Who do you think you are to reject this tradition that millions of your fellow countrymen, more intelligent and better people than you, have gladly accepted and given their lives to? So I think I'm more ready than I've ever been emotionally to hear how Christianity might be a force for good in Europe. Yet intellectually, I seem to have a sharper sense than ever of the gulf between the meta principles that define the Abrahamic faiths and those of paganism or the Dharmic faiths, which I regard as one commonality. I hope Laurent will say something that enables me to conceive the matter in a new and auspicious way. And with that, I warmly invite Laurent to address us. Please, sir.
Thank you very much. So let me begin my presentation. Is it okay for you?
Yeah.
So my presentation is entitled, is focused on the concept of the third of Rome, from Joseph of Arimathea to Dostoevsky. Before considering the concepts of the third Rome, let us examine the relationship between the first and the second Rome. Here in the West, in the Western world, we know of only one, the capital of the Roman Empire, which we are taught at school, collapsed in the year 476 with the deposition of Romulus Augustus. From Romulus, son of the god Mars, and suckled by a she-wolf, to Romulus Augustulus, who is Romulus the Small August. He was the son of the secretary of the Scourge of God, son of the secretary of Attila. The loop of imperial time closes on itself with such a great coherence, I would say. Here you can see a picture of Romulus Augustulus, Romulus the Small August, who was driven out at 14 years old by the rebel soldier Odoacre, in the year 476. And note that there were many rebellions of soldiers against emperors, Roman emperors at this time. They were Roman emperors, but they were living in Ravenna at this time, at the end of the 5th century. But the specificity of the rebellion of Odoacre is that he did not reclaim the title of emperor after having driven out Romulus Augustulus. He sent the imperial insignia to Constantinople. And after this event, Romulus was exiled from Ravenna to Campania. He was not killed. And the Western Roman Empire ends at this date. So 20 years, exactly 20 years before the baptism of Clovis. Okay, so we can learn these events at school. However, there is an heir to the Roman Empire, or rather an heiress. It is the Catholic and Orthodox Church. I insist on this point, the Catholic and Orthodox Church. I insist on this point since the early European Church is defined both by its universal character in space, that is Catholic, and by its permanence in time, eternally conforming to the doctrine of the Fathers, that is Orthodox. The double plenipotentiary character of this early church, both in space and time, is perfectly symbolized, from my point of view, by the cross, whose solidity of features reflects the power of the administrative structure. The administrative structure of the church was entirely dependent on the administrative structure of the Roman Empire, the first Rome. I would say that no European country, no European nation has inherited the Empire of Rome. It is the church itself that has inherited it. As Soloviev well explained in his book, Russia and the Universal Church, where he wrote the following sentences. Here is a sentence of Soloviev. The great powers of the ancient world have only passed through history. Rome alone still lives. The rock of the Capitol was consecrated by the biblical stone, and the Roman Empire was transformed into the great mountain, which in the prophetic vision was born of this stone. And the stone itself, what can it mean but the monarchical power of him who was called Peter par excellence, and on whom the universal church, this mountain of God, was founded. So I live in the city of Marseille in the south of France. I am particularly attached to the legend of the Saints of Provence, which strongly ties the country of France to the church in a deep and unique way, long before Clovis, 400 years before the arrival of Clovis, the so-called first French king. And to the displeasure of many of my friends to the displeasure of many traditional French nationalists who constantly link the birth of France to the date of Clovis' baptism, the Celtic inhabitants of Gaul did not wait until the year 496 to adopt Christianity. This is absolutely fundamental from my point of view. And this early Christianity, the Christianism of the first centuries in Gaul country, was as much Catholic as Orthodox. Okay. So, sorry, it is partly written in French, but there was the parenthesis, a huge parenthesis of Arianism at the first ages of Christianism. Here is a little bit complex structure of the evolution of Christianism, but let's take a look on the first Council of Nicea, 325, which proclaimed the consubstantiality of God and Jesus. And this was proclaimed against Arianism. Arianism was not a detail. It was not, I would say, a small heresy. Yeah. It was a deep and strong alternative vision of Christianism, since it was said to be not a Trinitarian Christianism, but a kind of dualist Christianism. In Arianism, Jesus, as you may know, is subordinated to God, and Jesus and God do not have really the same substance. And from my point of view, this Arianism heresy is very, very, very important. I even think that it is, we can, it's not the topic of my talk, but I'm strongly convinced by the fact that Arianism is today the great ideology of Western world, in a way. Here you have a map of the first centuries after Christ, and you can see that all the Mediterranean countries were under Arian rule, except the Eastern Rome, I would say the Byzantine world. But nevertheless, some Byzantine emperors were Arians, two or three of them, I believe. But you have Visigoth, you have Lombard, Ostrogoth, Burgundians, all the Northern Africa, due to the Vandal invasion, were under the Arianism rule, which is a pure dualist vision of Christianism. And here you have also another map. It is later on the sixth century, and you have a specific role of the Franks, the Belgium, the Franks, and as well as the Saxons. Franks and Saxons were not Arians at all at this time, but they were pagans and not Arians. They were you did not have many tribes at this time who were still pagans, except of course in the northern part of Europe, in the Scandinavian countries. I'm speaking about the Roman area. That is the reason why the Franks, when they arrived in Gaul, converted themselves so easily to Trinitarian Christianism, because they were not Arian. And the specific role of Franks in Gaul was to put out Arianism from Gaul after the battles of Vouillet, the Catalonic battles, and so on. Okay. As I said a few minutes ago, maybe we will discuss later about the very importance of Arianism, which was not a simple heresy. The inhabitants of Gaul at this time, at the first century, second century, converted very easily to the Trinitarian Christianism without any battle without any fights, I don't think it's so common that a new religion arrives in a given country and without any fights. I think that's the reason why the Celtic religion, which was practiced in secret, was also Trinitarian as well, and not dualist at all. And Arianism is also at the source of Catharism, for example. And if you take a look on the map of Gaul country, where the regions of Arianism were deeply attached to this dualist Christianism, curiously, it corresponds to the map of the Cathar heresy. And you have many other dualist spiritualities, for example, Islam. Please do not forget that many intellectuals of Islam, many Muslim intellectuals, pretend that Arianism was a pre-Islamic religion. So I think this is very important to understand. Today in France, there are three Orthodox churches. They are non-canonical, but very interesting Orthodox churches. The Celtic Orthodox Church, the French Orthodox Church, and the Orthodox Church of the Gauls. Why is it so important? Because for these churches, the term Orthodox does not refer to the Christianity of Eastern Europe or of Russia and so on. Not at all. Not at all. The term Orthodox for these churches refers primarily to the Celtic character of the early church of the first centuries in Gaul. So these churches are based on a Celtic rite, which was in a way modern, because this rite was revived in the 19th century. Of course, nobody knows what was the rite of the first centuries in Christianism, of course, but they pretend they refer directly to the legend of the saints of Provence. Since they mention the establishment of an ecclesia, a community of believers, by Joseph of Arimathea. This is a part of a picture by Perugino. So you may know that the legend of Saints of Provence pretend that Joseph of Arimathea arrived in Gaul in the year 43, the exact date is not so important, with 72 disciples of Jesus, with Mary Magdalene, Lazarus, her brother, Martha, her sister, and many other disciples. And Joseph of Arimathea arrived then in Provence at this time. He went then to Cornouailles. I don't remember exactly how you say Cornouailles in English.
Cornwall.
Yeah.
Everyone understands. Yeah. Okay. Laurent, if people have points about a slide or something you said to clarify, would you want them to speak now or wait until you finish?
No, maybe it's better now, because I fully agree. It's a discussion.
Okay, so yeah, please, anyone, if there's a point that you'd like Laurent to say something about in clarification, please raise it.
No problem. So Joseph of Arimathea followed the commercial way of étain, tin, maybe, of tin. And as you may know, of course, he had the Graal cup with him. And then when he arrived in Cornouailles, a new story began. Okay. So
No, I'd quite like to ask, just to clarify in my mind, these three Celtic Orthodox churches, they represent some form of early Catholicism, a belief in the Trinity, or do they follow an Arian understanding?
No, not at all. They are Trinitarian church. And they are, they are not Arian at all.
No, that's what I thought.
They pretend. I attended to five or six ceremonies. They pretend to be the or to represent the first Celtic Church of Gaul, and so their masters, I would say, are Marie Magdalene, Joseph of Arimathea, and so on. And they are fully in a Trinitarian Christianism, a real Christianism, I would say. But with a totally different rite. Totally different rite.
Yeah. I mean, and perhaps a totally different, or a different calendar, maybe. I know that that was a big issue.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. And this rite is as well based or assumed to be based on the first Celtic Gaul rites as Byzantine rites, because they pretend that the rites of the first centuries was more or less the same than the rites of Palestine, the rites of Syriac rite at this time. And it is one of the aims of my presentation, this idea, this vision of Christianism ended up with Templars, with the Knights of Templar, because as you may know, the Templars with Saint Bernard de Clairvaux also pretended to be based on a kind of Celtic vision of Christianism. And we know today that the rite of Knights of Templar was Byzantine also. It was Christianism, Christian, but Byzantine.
I mean, there was Celtic Christianity in Britain, and the same thing arose. The rites are well preserved. So this is not maybe a modern movement, but there is an authentic tradition, is there?
Of course. Nobody knows what was the rites of the first centuries, so that's why I say that they pretend to get it. And these three churches, which are now, as far as I know, unified in a single church, these three countries, these three churches have been have emerged in the 19th century only.
Okay, thanks. Mehran, I think you have your hand up.
Yes, I wonder if you can explain some kind of origin or the formation of those churches, because you know, formation of religions in a very turbulent time must be a very dynamic and very complex and advanced process. I mean, the Celtics and the France and the Gauls, it seems like it's about tribes forming their own churches. Have you any is it tribes or is it some kind of national movement? What is this about? I mean, you talk about, you know, formation of churches in early time, in very turbulent time, and it's a very advanced kind of act,
yeah,
isn't it? It's very, you know, it's not so easy to form a church.
Of course.
Explanation, please.
There are two different points. There is the existence of these churches, which is very interesting, but as I said, which is based on rights coming from 19th century. But they did many historical works in order to try to know what was the rights of the first centuries. This is the first point. And the second point, I will explain in the next slides. The second point is what was how was this church in Gaul in the first centuries? How did it form? This is a very important point. I don't think that the first and second centuries was so disturbed in Gaul. The Roman Empire in the first century was more or less pacified. One thing is sure, the Celtic religion based on Druidism and so on was absolutely forbidden by the pagan Roman Empire. It was absolutely and strictly forbidden to exercise the pagan Druidic religion. And we know today that we have many Christians who arrived in the south of France, I would say from the middle of the first century. Of course, the legend of the Saints of Provence pretends that these first Christians were Mary Magdala, Joseph of Arimathea, Lazarus, Martha, and so on. And I strongly believe to this version, but okay. And these people managed, as far as we know, as far as historians describe, they managed to convert many inhabitants of the southern Gaul to Christianism. It was very easy. And 50 years after, or maybe 100 years after, you already had the first established Christian church in France, which was in Lyon. Still forbidden, of course. That is the reason why you had many martyrs in Lyon, Saint Blandine, Saint Irénée de Lyon. You had many intellectuals. Saint Irénée de Lyon was a famous theologian, father of church. But we know that the number of Christians was very important at this time. And it extended a lot within dozens of years to Orléans, to Poitiers, to the north of France, without any, you never had any fights, you never had any problems. And my belief, I'm not the only one to say this, my belief is that since the Celtic people had not the possibility to practice their Celtic religion because it was forbidden to death, maybe at the first years, at the first time, Christianism, at least before the year 150, Christianism was more or less tolerated in the southern part of France. Much more tolerated than Druidism, than Celtic religion. And I think that the inhabitants of Gaul maybe found that the difference between Celtic religion and Christianism was not so important. I strongly believe that these people saw in Jesus a kind of coronation of Celtic religion. I saw in the southern, in village, very old village in the southern part of France, I saw a representation of Jesus in very old wooden doors before the 10th century. And Jesus is graved in this wooden door as a small creature of the forest, you know? Un lutin, how do you call it? The small creature of forest, this magical, so he is represented with the ears like this, and with a very malicious eyes, and I think that there was no confusion, but I really think that Christianism was seen like a kind of coronation of Celtic religion. That is one of the reasons why, for me, I do not see, for me, the fight between paganism and Christianism should not happen. It is a fight which impedes us to build something serious. And it is also a fight which never happened, at least until the Renaissance period. I think that even during Middle Ages and so on, there was not, if you read Rabelais, if you read all the great authors from the Middle Ages before Renaissance, you can see that the authors were as Christians are pagan, as pagan. Okay. So there are many traces. I live in Marseille since 20 years. I was born in Lyon. There are many, many traces of the presence of Sainte Marie Magdalene in Marseille, which is a Greek city. Huh? Marseille is the only French city which was not founded by Roman, but by Greeks. And that's the reason why it's a key city at the junction between Western and Eastern Christianism. For example, here is a picture of the place where many people believe that Mary Magdalena landed. She was exiled from Ephesia. As you may know, Saint John, Mary Magdalena, and the Virgin Mary lived together, maybe during 10 years, in Ephesia. And then their community was attacked by some Jews in Ephesia, and they escaped to France, to Gaul. Here you have a church which is based on the southern shore of the old harbor in Marseille, and you have this crypt of Saint Lazarus, which is the oldest Christian sanctuary in France. So you have Marie Magdalena here, and here you have a picture of her brother, Saint Lazarus, who was the first Archbishop of Marseille. In the Cathedral of Marseille, you have the relics of Saint Lazarus. You have here his head, his crane. This cathedral is based on the northern shore of the harbor. And a part of these relics have been transferred to Bourgogne in the 9th century, and then you can find many traces of the relics of Saint Lazare in many places of Europe. But the first place is here. It is also one of the traces of the existence of Marie Magdalena in Marseille. I invite any of you to come in Marseille for a few days. It will be a pleasure for me to make a visit for you. This is the Church of Chartreux. Chartreux is a very important Catholic order. And you can see on the door, you have the sculpture of Marie Magdalena on the right and the picture of Saint Bruno, who founded the Chartreux order, on the left. As you maybe you know that the Saint Bruno's vow of silence, which is the rule of the Carthusian monks, is modeled on the silence in which Saint Marie Magdalene lived for 30 years on the mountain of Saint Baume of the northern part of Marseille. Here, for example, you have a small church in the northern parts of Marseille, where you have a statue of Saint Marie Magdalene. You will never find this in any guide of the city. Huh? Okay, here is a sanctuary, a church, a very old church of the Carme order. I can speak of this later. And here you have, here we have the Basilic of Marseille. And at the end of the picture, you can see the mountain of La Sainte-Baume. Mountain of La Sainte-Baume. Every time you go to a museum in the world, if you take a look on pictures of Sainte Marie Magdalena, you always see her in a cave, crying in a cave. This cave is the cave of La Sainte-Baume, which is directly which protects the city of Marseille. Okay, this is the mountain of La Sainte-Baume. Here you can see the church. So there is a cave in a church. It is a very mystic part of Provence. Okay, and here are the relics of Saint Marie Magdalena with the crane, which are in a small village close to La Sainte-Baume. Okay, so the Druidism, as I told you a few minutes ago, the Druidism was forbidden to death by the Roman paganism. Let me say that 3 million of Gaul inhabitants were exterminated, killed to death by the Roman Empire, by the pre-Christian Roman Empire, which is third of the total number of inhabitants. They were slaved or killed. The Celtic Christianity will know its apogee with Saint Bernard de Clairvaux. The Druid monk, we say that he was a Druid monk. His friend, Saint Malachy of Armagh, and the Templars, of course, whose rite was probably Byzantine. And this is so the continuation. All this story is the continuation of the first Rome in the Western world, not on the Eastern world. I will speak in a few minutes about the Eastern Rome. And this continuation of the first Rome in the Western world existed until the political emergence of the Franks, of the Charlemagne, and the emergence of the Holy Roman German Empire, which was the beginning of something else, totally something else. So now I come to the second Rome, which is Constantinople, Byzance, Constantinople. Here you have some ruins of Constantinople. And the second Rome was intended to be the capital of a universal empire. Contrary to what modern Western historians write, it seems that the fall of Rome did not take place in the year 476, as I told you at the beginning of my speech. But on, we know precisely the date, Tuesday, it was a Tuesday, May 29th, 1453, under the blows of the Sultan Mehmet II. Between these two events, between the fall of the Western Rome and the fall of the Eastern Rome, Byzance, Constantinople, 1,000 years after. There was a split in the Christian Church, of course, as you all know, resulting in the emergence of Catholicism in the West and Orthodoxy in the East. It is the famous schism of 1054. Was the famous schism of 1054 really the cause of this fracture? The official reasons for the separation, for this separation, are said to be based on completely incompatible theological visions between the Latins and the Greeks. This is the official version. The best known theological problem being the filioque dispute. These theological oppositions were the cause or the consequence of historical oppositions. Since, on the one hand, the Holy Roman Empire considered itself in many aspects to be the only true heir of the Roman Empire, and on the other hand, the fall of the Byzantine Empire corresponded more or less with the advance of the so-called Renaissance in the Western world. So, to tell the truth, I think that the real political schism between the two worlds was not 1054, but it was the Fourth Crusade with the vandalism of Constantinople by the Venetian soldiers, which definitively marked the fracture between the two worlds. So it is here and now that I would like to mention the thoughts of Jean Romanides, which is a priest, an Orthodox theologian from the 20th century. He was doctor of the University of Athens and professor at the Faculty of Theology of Thessaloniki from 1968. A collection of texts translated into French was published a few years ago, Théologie empirique. Romanides developed a very interesting point of view. For me, it's absolutely crucial. Why is it so crucial? Because when I speak with many Orthodox friends, I have even I have friends who are Pope in Romania. They have all more or less the same vision of Jean Romanides, who was an intellectual and who managed to clarify them. According to Jean Romanides, the schism of 1054 is not the result of a progressive gap between Latins and Greeks, but it is a product of the Frankish Latinization of Orthodoxy. Namely, the policy of the Franks imposed on the popes and on the Celto-Christian monasticism. Franks imposed a new theology to Latin Western Christian world. So these thoughts appear to be quite common in Orthodox world, as I said to you. And they pretend, if you understand, that Catholicism is a Christian world which lost its Orthodox aspects. Okay. Let me read you two very significant extracts from text by Jean Romanides on this theme. First extract. Instead of explaining the history of the church by teaching that the indivisible unity of the Roman nation had been split in two by the Germanic invasions, most historians of European culture treated the history of the church as if there were a Latin Christianity and a Greek Christianity. Greek Christianity covers the Romans of the East, while Latin Christianity corresponds to the German Franks, who became Latin-speaking. Thus, the myth was born that the church fathers, the Western Romans, the Franks, the Lombards, and so on, formed a harmonious and historically unified Latin Christianity, clearly distinct and different from the equally mythical Greek Christianity. And it is this framework of the Greek East and the Latin West that has been accepted without reservation for so many centuries by Western historians. However, only a more accurate understanding of the historical framework would allow the filioque controversy to be placed in its true perspective and to be legitimately based on the Roman point of view relative to the history of the church, which is reflected in the Roman sources, Greek and Latin. All these sources show the real opposition between Roman and Frankish Christianity, but not the purely mythical opposition between Greek and Latin Christianity. For the Romans, Latin and Greek were used to designate national languages, not nations. Thus, the church fathers were neither Latin nor Greek, they were Roman. So, the great schism for Jean Romanides was not 1054, but few hundred years ago, the creation of the papal states by the Franks, by Pépin le Bref. Let me cite you a very exciting second excerpt from Jean Romanides. Monasticism was the greatest obstacle to the Frankish Latinization of Orthodoxy. I repeat, monasticism was the greatest obstacle to the Frankish Latinization of Orthodoxy. Was it not, in fact, the guardian of the biblical tradition of the prophets and apostles, the very heart of the patristic tradition? The Franks knew the strength of monasticism because when they conquered Gallo-Romania in the 5th century, Orthodox monasticism had reached its highest point. So they stopped choosing bishops from among the monks and turned the bishops into administrators responsible for the enslaved people. Finally, the Frankish Carolingians drove out the Roman bishops. They established themselves as bishops and abbots, cooperated with their Frankish fellow citizens, became oppressive policemen of the people, and kept them in slavish obedience by the institution of a religion of fear. This is undoubtedly why so many Frankish clerics were killed by the Gallo-Romans during the Revolution, the French Revolution. This last sentence is hard, very cruel, but okay. So Jean Romanides saw in the Revolution of 1789 a revenge of the Romans against the Franks, at least partially, of course. A revenge of the Romans against the Franks, noting, many historians, French historians have noted the same thing, that some revolutionaries asked to take back the name of Romans, abandoning that of French. A revenge of the people, of the Celtic people, I would say, against the French institutions coming from abroad, coming from another ethnic tribe, I would say, Germans. This is the theme of the parish against the castles, a theme which was developed by Grasset d'Orsay in the 19th century, and which was developed by many monarchist historians in the 19th century in France. So they say that you have two Christianisms in opposition. First, a Celtic parish and popular. Second, a Frank, aristocratic and episcopal. And you have, and some people explain that this is the reason why in France you have a so deep, abyssal fracture between Provence and Paris since 2,000 years. So what is particularly interesting to me is that by insisting that the church fathers were neither Latin nor Greek, but Roman, Jean Romanides was highlighting the historical existence of a common basis for Catholics and Orthodox, which is the very important point for me. He even wrote the following sentence: "The Church of Rome never separated from Orthodoxy, but on the contrary, was destroyed, conquered by force by the non-Roman Franks, and disappeared. This made Father Fontrier, who is an Orthodox French Pope, this made Father Fontrier say that by becoming Orthodox, the French are simply returning to the faith of their ancestors, which is entirely based on the tradition of the saints of Provence." Romanides, of course, also mentioned the importance of fundamental importance of Jean Cassien, who is a fundamental figure, who was a true golden bridge between Constantinople and Rome, between the first and the second Rome. He arrived in Marseille in the year 416 to found the Abbey of Saint-Victor. I showed you the crypt of Saint Victor, of Saint Lazarus, a few minutes ago. And he dug stairs on the slopes of mountain of Sainte-Baume. These stairs are still present today. This is a contemporary picture. Jean Cassien, in the 5th century, and his disciples dug stairs on the slopes of the Sainte-Baume to facilitate access to the cave of Saint Marie Magdalene. So he knew perfectly the existence, the passage of Saint Marie Magdalene in the city of Marseille 400 years before. This is to counter definitively, I hope, the neo-Cathar claim that the Dominicans created the myth of Marie Magdalene presence at the Sainte-Baume in the 13th century from scratch, in order to be stronger to fight the Cathar. It's absolutely false. Please note that the cave of Sainte Marie Magdalene has always been sacred, being formerly a place of veneration of Artemis of Ephesus. Artemis of Ephesus was a king of Marseille before the Christianism, before the arrival of Marie Magdalene. Marseille was devoted to Artemis and Apollon as well, her brother. Lucan, the writer Lucan, wrote magnificent pages about the forest of the Sainte-Baume. Here you have pictures of the church of Marie Magdalene, which is in the cave of Sainte-Baume, where she is supposed to live during 30 years. During our discussions, dear Stead, we have talking about the relation with the Tarot of Marseille. It can be the topic of a full conference. I can just tell my idea to be frank and honest. My strong belief is that Jean Cassien, who was sent in France by Saint Jean Chrysostome from Constantinople, I strongly believe that Jean Cassien drew himself the cards of the Tarot of Marseille, following the, I would say, after having found some words of Saint Marie Magdalene in the city of Marseille. But if you are interested on this, we can speak on this later.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
Okay. In his introduction to the book of Jean Romanides, Monseigneur Filaret explains...
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
You highlight the role of Marseille, and that made me think about, you know, the prophecies of Nostradamus and why South France and especially Marseille has a key role. Any thought about that? Because it's also about, you know, some kind of French historical philosophy, I'm giving it a certain, you know, trajectory, direction. Is there anything, you know, you have included in your theology or in your, where the history is ahead, and what kind of play role this very place plays? Any comments, any thoughts, or is that something that you will address later? Thank you.
No, I did not intend to speak of this, but it is a crucial question, but very, very difficult. From a pure historical point of view, we know that you have at this time in the first century many trading roads, maritime trading roads between Marseille and Palestine. Because at this time, Marseille was the most important city in Gaul, much more than Lyon. Lyon became very important 300 or 400 years after. You had a very important university in Marseille, and you had also, we say, maybe the first novel writer, of course, after Homer and Ulysse novel, but the real first novelist writer of the Roman Empire. I've forgotten his name. His book was adapted by Fellini on the cinema. Satyricon by Petron. Petron, le Marseillais. Petron was an inhabitant of Marseille. This was a very important city. So I guess then, from a pure, I would say, historical point of view, when the disciples of Jesus were put into a boat, since you had many, many maritime roads between Palestine and Marseille, their arrival in Marseille was natural, I think. They should have been accompanied by some other boats and so on.
May I add something else? Just a short. Did people from Marseille and in France all the time knew about, you know, the holy figures and the disciples and, you know, Maria Magdalena? Is that, has this thinking been known all the time during the history of Christianity in southern France?
Yes, many kings came to La Sainte-Baume, to this place. Even Louis XIV, François Ier, many kings came to this cave to pray, to give presents, and so on. You have, and they came also to many other cities around this place. For example, in Tarascon, which is a small city close to La Sainte-Baume, you have the relics of Saint Marthe, the sister of Marie Magdalene. In the city of Apt, the city of Apt is in the heart of Luberon, so very close to La Sainte-Baume, you have the relics of Saint Anne, the mother of the Virgin Mary. These relics have been taken by Marie Magdalene and her disciples. And all along the French history, and certainly from, I would say, the 13th century, this story has been very intense. On the 19th century, it was more and more intense. You had processions, and you know, at the end of the 19th century, it was at this time that the church said that France was the elder daughter of church, and this sentence, France is the elder daughter of France, of church, this sentence is directly linked to the legend of the saints of Provence.
And the last one, I want this kind of, you know, preserving the skulls and bones of saints and holy people. What is that a kind of pagan way of, you know, respecting the dead? Or is that this is so unchristian to just, you know, have they been buried ever, or have the skulls always been, you know, preserved for the public? Yeah, thank you.
The relics, at least of Saint Marie Magdalene, the relics have been hidden in the eighth century, because at this time you had many invaders, and most of all you had many Saracens, Muslims, coming in the south of France. And so the priests hide the relics, the skulls and bones of Marie Magdalena, in a given cave. And these relics were rediscovered on the 13th century. So they were hidden during a few centuries. So you have many stories about this. I would just add another point, which is very exciting. Many esoterist writers think, they say, why Christianism arrived in Gaul? They say this is simply because Jesus arrived from Gaul. And you have many theories. I am not necessarily agree with them, but you have many theories who say that Jesus was ethnically Celtic, ethnically Gaul. That's the reason why he lived in Galilee. Galilee was the region of Gaul, you see. And you have also many theories, but these theories were not esoteric. They were officially approved by monarchy, at least by Merovingian and Carolingian kings. They say that the Franks origin is in Palestine. They say that the Franks origin is from the city of Troyes in Turkey, of Troyes. And before this period, they came from Palestine. So you have many, and this was officially approved by the first Merovingian kings. So you have this is a thing which I would agree. So you have many theories which we put into relation Gaul and Palestine. Okay. So I was reading the introduction to the book of Jean Romanides. He says, Monseigneur Filaret explains, the Roman Empire was bilingual, and to oppose, as is sometimes done, the Latin fathers and the Greek fathers is to project into the past a situation which only existed after the Frankish conquest, and which saw a Frankish Christianity, known as Latin, confronting an Orthodox Christianity known as Greek. The concept of Romanity allows us to place the disputes and struggles we are talking about in their true context. This framework is that of the fundamental unity of Roman civilization. Romanity is, please listen to this, Romanity is the Roman Empire turned Christian and its civilization. So here is a concept very important for contemporary geopolitics, from Lisbon to Vladivostok. We understand here that the concept of a unified Europe from Lisbon to Vladivostok has very deep roots, Christian roots. And Romanides, by the way, supported the project of the political restoration of the Roman Empire under the name of Romania, a project that resonates with the notion of a third Rome, in the sense that only Orthodoxy today, politically, could be in a position to achieve such a grand continental reintegration, which was the main topic of this writer, Jean Parvulescu. He talked about an imperial Christological transfiguration. So let me give some words about Jean Parvulescu, this writer, which for me is absolutely fundamental. And then I will give some words about the Third Rome. Jean Parvulescu worked a lot on geopolitics, and he defended the fact that geopolitics is directly linked to theology, and then geopolitics was a sacred science, a sacred human science. Who was Jean Parvulescu? He was born in 1929 in Romania. He crossed the iron and fire curtains of communism after the Second World War to find himself in Paris, in the most advanced circles of the literary, artistic, and cinematographic avant-garde at this time, as well as in the most perilous sentinels of clandestine political action, from the Madrid OAS to the Gaullist conspiracy of the post-De Gaulle period. So he was very well known in the cinema, in the Nouvelle Vague, and so on. Okay, and for Jean Parvulescu, and this is the main thrust of his novels, he wrote maybe 30 or 35 books, the advent of being will pass through the re-establishment of the empire, but extended to the entire Euro-Asian continent, according to a central axis formed by Paris, Berlin, and Moscow. This axial concept, of which General de Gaulle had a revolutionary intuition as early as 1949, and to which the opposition of France, Germany, and Russia to the invasion of Iraq offered a draft of realization in 2003, he had been the first to give a precise doctrinal formulation in an article in 1980. And you will not be surprised if I tell you that Jean Parvulescu was a great friend of Alexander Dugin. The Eurasian, it would be perfectly wrong to attribute this imperial vocation to any will to power. It is even the exact opposite. The Eurasian empire of the end, dreamed of by Jean Parvulescu, is not an end, but a means. It is the vessel that will lead to the peace of being that has finally come under the eternal, timeless, and universal imperium of Mary, to whom Jean Parvulescu devotes a personal and experimental cult. The last time such a reintegration between West and East Europe came close to taking place, not politically, but strictly theologically, it was with the Council of Florence. A decree of union between Greeks and Latins, validated at the Basilica of Saint Sophie on December 1452. 5 months before the fall of Constantinople, 1452, which displayed the ambition of reaching, reaching the definition of certain theological truths and doctrinal norms, which serve as a guide to the spirits who hope for the end of the schism. This agreement almost turned history on its head by proclaiming the agreement between Latins and Greeks on crucial theological and dogmatic points, such as the procession of the Holy Spirit, the principle of the Eucharistie, the primacy of the Pope, and the filioque, which is, as you know, fundamental. The Council of Nicea in the year 3025 proclaims, "We believe in the Holy Spirit who proceeds from the Father." And some people added some years after. We believe in the Holy Spirit who proceeds from the Father and the Son. Ex patre filioque procedit, and the Son. But please do not forget that this ad filioque procedit was not an invention of Catholic Church, as we hear too often. Not at all. This was first introduced at the Third Council of Toledo at the end of the 6th century by the Visigoths. During the Third Council of Toledo, the Visigoths proclaimed the abandonment of Arianism, and then they proclaimed that they were Christian, Trinitarian Christian, and they introduced this filioque. And this filioque was proclaimed in Frankish Gaul against the opinion of the Latin Church. First, it was Charlemagne, Carolus Magnus, Charlemagne, who introduced the filioque at the Council of Aix-la-Chapelle in the year 809 through Theodulf, and it was first refused by the Pope, Leo III. It was first refused. This shows that the constitution of the Carolingian Empire could not take place without the constitution of a Frankish church with its own theology and denomination, a church under the features of the Papal States founded 50 years before by Pépin the Short, Pépin le Bref. On the subject of the filioque, Romanides writes more particularly, it is therefore essential to understand that this controversy of the filioque was not a conflict between the patriarch of Old Rome and New Rome, but between the Franks and all the Romans of the East and West. This filioque question was greatly, I would say, resolved by Andrei Rublev in this icon of the Trinity. You have the Father in the center under the tree, the oak of Mambre. You have the Son on the right under the mountain, and you have the Spirit on the left under the tent of Abraham. And the Father is facing the Son and looking at the Spirit. So you have here an iconic resolution of the filioque problem. This is absolutely fantastic. And so the Council of Florence followed a numerous attempt at union because you have many many attempts before the Council of Florence. You had many Byzantine emperors who asked the popes for military help, mostly against the Ottomans. John V, Paleologue, for example, asked the Pope for help at the end of the 14th century. You have many examples. And the Greek Orthodox were suspicious because every time that the Byzantine emperor asked military help to the Pope said, okay, but you make a union with us Catholic. And of course, the emperors never accepted to become Catholic again. So you had 100 years during which the Second Rome asked for political and military help from the First Rome, which in return asked for spiritual allegiance. After this date, after the Council of Florence, after the signature of the Council of Florence, this council was considered by the Russians as an apostasy. It was absolutely rejected by the Russians. Only the Greek validated it. But the Council of Florence was could have been a great historical turning point. But as I said, 5 months after it was signed, the Second Rome fell and then moved to the banks of the Moskva. Because Sophie Paleologue, she was the niece of the last Byzantine emperor, Constantine XI was killed during the capture of Constantinople. Sophie Paleologue married Ivan III, the great prince of Moscow and all of Russia, and she transferred to Moscow the coat of arms of the two-headed eagle. Then Caesar became Tsar, and the agreement with the Golden Horde was torn up. And then Moscow considered itself as the third Rome. Sophie Paleologue married with Ivan III in Rome. It was blessed by a pope, Sixtus IV. But after that, she converted, I would say, to Russian Orthodoxy. Okay. And Ivan IV, after that, crowned himself a Tsar of all the Russia. So from the outset, this notion of a third Rome was as much political as religious, and even took on eschatological overtones, in particular in the mind of the monk Philotheus from the monastery of Skof. He was the first to formulate it clearly in his famous letters to Vasily III. He wrote the famous sentence to the Tsar: all the Christian kingdoms have disappeared and are now united within your empire. Two Romes have fallen, but the third is standing, and there will be no fourth, which is the most important point in his sentence, I believe. So it is a pure eschatological view of Christianity. There will be no fourth Rome. So the notion of Russia as a universal empire, as a third Rome ruled jointly by the emperor and the patriarch, gained ground in many quarters. It was undoubtedly at the heart of the quarrel of the old believers in Russia. And it was probably the actions of Peter the Great that opposed it most strongly with the build of St. Petersburg and the Europeanization of Russia. Now, maybe I will arrive to the end of my talk. Let us now turn to Dostoevsky and his personal vision of Russia's eschatological and providential mission. He put again on the first line the concept of third Rome. One could quote dozens of sentences, each one more enlightening than the last on the subject. I will not quote extracts from novels, as the opinions of the characters do not necessarily reflect those of the author. But let me give extract from his diary. First extract, 1876. Moscow, this center of the great Russia, still has a bright future ahead of it. The prophecy must be fulfilled, for there will be no fourth Rome, and the universe will not be the same. Rome and the universe will not do without a Rome. Dostoevsky's letter to Nikolai Strakhov in 1869. The essence of Russian destiny consists in revealing to the world a Russian Christ, unknown to the universe, whose principle is contained in our orthodoxy. In my opinion, this is where the elements of the future civilizing power of the resurrection of Europe by us, The whole destiny of Russia is in orthodoxy, in the light of the East, which will flow to the blind humanity of the West, which has lost Christ. Here is a French writer whose name was Paul Morand. he wrote between the year 30s to 60, 70s. And he wrote a fundamental book, L'Europe russe annoncée par Dostoevsky, Russian Europe announced by Dostoevsky. It was published in 1948. From my point of view, this is the most important, I would say, prophetic French books of the 20th century. In 14 short chapters, Paul Morand analyzes Dostoevsky prophecies, attributing their veracity to the sacred evil of epilepsy, particularly with regard to the messianic aspect of Russia's the rescue of European civilization. So first, he says that Dostoevsky was announcing the death of Europe when Europe was at its peak, which is absolutely incredible. Paul Morand writes, "To announce the end of Europe in 1876 was strange, to say the least. Asia was about to be conquered. The annexation of Africa and Oceania was coming to an end. America was just asking to be the extension of her peninsula. Victorious peace reigned. Austria, welded to Hungary, was building an imposing dam on the ruins of the Ottoman Empire. Prestige of this world, Europe, its granaries, its banks, its forges, its museums, still contain all the possibilities of life. No one can do anything without it, against it. No doctor has diagnosed the deadly disease in this flourishing body. No prophet has dared to threaten it with what will soon be. One man, only one, Fedor Dostoevsky, stood up and had the nerve to say, it is finished." It should be noted, of course, that Friedrich Nietzsche also wrote a few years after, "Europe is a world that is collapsing," but their intentions were not the same. What is Europe dying of, according to Dostoevsky? From individualism, nationalism, it's very important. As you know, nationalism was first a left-wing idea. Nationalism is against the imperial idea. So nationalism for Dostoevsky, for many people who love the concept of empire, is a pure progressist and left-wing idea. From socialism, of course, from the Jew and his bank, said Dostoevsky. And also from Rome, from an Orthodox point of view. Paul Morand writes, "Ancient Rome had invented the universal monarchy from which the Christian world emerged. But in the Middle Ages, this new edifice split in two. The popes are responsible for this rupture. Europe lost its unity because in the West," very important, "because in the West, the church became a state, while in the East, remaining in the truth, made the state the church. The Byzantine Empire was a totalitarian state that was one with the church. Russia, however, is the daughter of Byzantium. It is the northern heir of those Greeks of the Lower Empire who annexed Hellenism and imbibed its immense superiority complex over the barbarians, the non-Greek. Byzantium had nothing but contempt for the restless Franks descended from the barbarians," and so on. Dostoevsky always accuses Rome of wanting to participate in the essence of the temporal state, whose flesh is mortal, and thus of having condemned itself to decline and disappear. The diary of Dostoevsky calls Rome a dead church and the Pope an old fool. But he adds, "This old fool is the most interesting man in Europe. Roman rites will collapse with Western society, being only social signs. what could he say today? Truth may have been in Rome, but Christ is no longer there. The West has lost Christ through the fault of Catholicism, and that is why the West is dying, only for that. But if Europe is against Russia, Russia is not against Europe, for the Russian's destiny is unquestionably pan-European and pan-world. He is the universal man. Paul Moron titles one chapter, Russia or the Flood, in 1948. And another, The Third Rome. It's as simply as that. And in this chapter, The Third Rome, there are these absolutely shocking sentences. Having examined each of the great peoples of Europe in turn, and concluded that none is strong enough to impose its law on the others, Dostoevsky arrives at Moscow by elimination. Here we enter the realm of faith and love. The Russian God is the best, for it is not by violence, but in an absolutely new way that his people, inspired by him, will want to make Europe happy, and they will succeed thanks to his faculties of sympathy and synthesis. It will be the aliens of love. The new Slavic idea is the third and perhaps the last possibility offered to settle the destiny of Europe. And above all, a little further on, about the French Catholic writer Léon Blois, who was a real eschatological writer. We are waiting for someone, proclaims the infortunate Léon Blois at the other end of the continent. What they are waiting for is my country, Dostoevsky will reply. Russia is fatality. It is the hope of the world. It is the force of things. Europe will really come knocking at our door so that we will rise up and go to her to save order. Let us make no mistake about it. This order will not be the one who have been used to. It will be a scandalous order. Just as Prince Myshkin breaks the vase in the general's house, so in Dostoevsky's house, the spirit will break matter to the amazement of all. Then the world will be discovered as it should be. And the following sentence by Morand should be learned by heart, because it is so sublime. The feeling of humiliation which makes revolutions will be succeeded by humility which makes religions. Then he ends this chapter, the third Rome, as follows. Even in Russia, those who thought they were making use of Christ will only have been its instruments. Thus will the reign of God be established. We have not yet reached that hour. We must first descend to the depths of our night consciousness under the total pressure of misfortune and the weight of the force of things. Perhaps we can better understand Dostoevsky's warning by recalling the last words of Léon Blois in his diary, which is very famous in France. I am waiting for the Cossack and the Holy Spirit. Léon Blois was convinced that Christianity is not an end. This is very important. Christianity is not an end. It is the historical preamble to another era, which will be that of Christ the Judge, the Second Coming, the Parousia, the regime of the third person of the Holy Trinity. Léon Blois was the disciple of Joseph de Maistre, the French writer who fought against the French Revolution, and who wrote, he was a real Catholic, but he wrote, nevertheless, one day there will be a new religion, which will be to Christianity what Christianity was to Judaism. And I think that these pages have a direct and obvious resonance with our contemporary events. The concept of Third Rome is not only historical, but theological. It also designed the reign of Holy Spirit. Maybe you know the work of Joachim de Flore, the monk of the Napolitan monk of the Middle Ages, who pretend also that after the reign of the Father, the reign of the Son, you will get the reign of Holy Spirit. Today, we must understand that the relationship between East and West has been completely reversed since the Council of Florence, since the 15th century. It is rather today the first Rome that is going to draw spiritual renewal from the third Rome in exchange for social, intellectual, and why not political help. In the 14th century, Constantinople asked Rome for help against the Turks coming from the East. Today, we ask Orthodoxy, we ask Moscow for help against the invaders from the West who have established the empire of non-being, the empire of non-being since 1945. We are asking for help against the dangers coming from the West, the same dangers that Dostoevsky identified perfectly. So it would be a mistake to see the Third Rome only as a bulwark against Islam. The enemy we all face is the global conspiracy against the Virgin Mary. Jean Parvulescu wrote that the global conspiracy against the Virgin Mary is both the external subversion of globalization and the internal subversion of nihilistic alienation, Marxist and Masonic, in its ultimate paroxysmal dimensions. So for France and the West, are well and truly under the radical sway of the powers of darkness, manipulated by the Atlantic powers. The Polish and Ukrainians have taken the risk of setting Europe on fire again, reinstalling chaos on the Eurasian continent. So let me give some 1 or 2 minutes of for talking about politics, contemporary politics.
Laurent, I think we, you know, we're getting towards 2 hours. So is it possible?
Okay.
I'm sure lots of people have some points to make, I think. So perhaps if we can sort of move it towards a conclusion, okay. So we can open the discussion.
Okay. So I go to the end. I was saying that the Azov military section, who are blessed by the Western world, Bernard-Henri Lévy, these troops, are frontally against Russia. And this is, for example, one sentence of Olga Semeniaka, who is one of the main figures of Azov Party. And she talks about Aryan Luciferianism. So one of my message is to take care about some far right lectures of Evola, of Ernst Junger, who are directly linked to the Arianism I was talking at the beginning of my talk. At the same time, we have organized with Alexander Dugin and Yuri Roska a colloquium in Moldavia, who are directly linked to the concept of Third Rome and Dostoevsky's ideas. Here is Vyacheslav Ivanov, and I finish with this concept of going beyond Christianity, because I will finish with this idea. Vyacheslav Ivanov developed the Dostoevsky's prophetic genius in his book, Tragedy, Myth, Religion. He insists on the announcement of the Third Russia concomitant to the Third Rome, after Tsarist Russia, after Bolshevik Russia. Here comes the Russia of the reign of Christ, and he writes that Dosto's thoughts go beyond Christianism. And here is what Jean Parvulescu writes about this work, specifying that this notion of Third Rome can be understood in a sense that goes beyond Christianity. The unification of European continents is the only pragmatic idea today. he says, Jean Parvulescu says that we have to understand that the spiritual and metaphysical underworld of Dostoevsky's work join the archaic mystery of Greek tragedy and is subject to the abysmal solicitations of the European mythology that constitutes our earliest origins. That his own space was that of the ultimate depths of European being, and of the powerful reverberations of this in the irrational, mystical Russian consciousness stretched towards the beyond of history. And so please read the speech on Pushkin, the speech of Dostoevsky on Pushkin, delivered on June 1880, where Dostoevsky clearly says, the destiny of the Russian is pan-European and universal. The division between Slavophiles and Westerners is only the result of a gigantic misunderstanding. A true Russian is as much interested in the destiny of Europe, in the destiny of the whole great Aryan race, as in that of Russia. This is precisely what Jean Parvulescu called the abysmal solicitations of the European mythology that constitutes our primary origins. Jean Parvulescu was born in Romania. He converted to Catholicism when he arrived in Western Europe. And for Parvulescu, the reintegration of the churches into a new imperial religion, not to be confused with some kind of modernist ecumenism, of course. The reintegration of the church into a new imperial religion will have to take place under the aegis of the Indo-European Boreal Arc. He was a reader of Savitri Devi. He was a reader of Pierre Gordon. He wrote a superb review of the book of Dominique Venner, History and Tradition of European. So that is the reason why I was telling at the beginning that today there is, today and even before, there is no deep rupture between paganism and Christianism. And I finish my talk with the last sentence of Jean Parvulescu, which he wrote in his last novel. For the first time since indefinite times, since the end of the Neolithic period itself, men of the same blood and belonging to the same fundamental vision of being and of the world, to the same profound civilization, find themselves together again, ready to integrate the ancient unity of their common predestination from the Atlantic to the Pacific. Okay, so I have finished. Thank you
very much, Laurent. Thanks for sharing a vision which is clearly dear to you and lodged in your heart. Michael, you going? Please ask a question and then go. I think he's got to go. Michael, have you got time? If you could unmute and.
It was a very interesting talk. I really can't stay any longer. But I was just going to ask about the Skull of Mary Magdalene in St. Maximin La Baume. And I was just curious because I've always heard that there are two other skulls of her in the south of France and how that all gets resolved. I was wondering about that.
I did not really understood the.
All right, there's a skull of Mary Magdalene in St. Maximin La Baume.
Yeah.
It used to be up in the main part of the church. The last time I was there, it was now moved down to the crypt. Yeah. And it was originally, you would approach it, you'd see all her golden hair in a and then you go around to the other side, and then you solve the skull in this golden container. But I've always heard that that's only one of three skulls that are claimed to be of Mary Magdalene.
Ah.
I'm just wondering how that gets resolved in your your analysis.
Yes, I believe you have a cave, a grave of Saint Mary Magdalene in Éphèse, in Ephesia. If you go
to Saint Maximin Le Baume, you must know that because it's not very far from Marseille. It has her skull, or it claims to be her skull.
Ah, yes. That's what I was talking about. At Saint Maximin, which is very close to Saint Baume, there is the skull of Saint Mary Magdalene. It has even been studied by science people. It was dated by carbon 14, and you have many scientific studies. They definitively say that it is the skull of a woman from the first century, coming from.
Palestine, I guess.
Exactly. This is for sure. But you have also a skull of Marie Magdalene in Vézelay, in Bourgogne. But I think this is not very interesting dispute. In fact, today in Vézelay, You don't have the skull of Marie Magdalene. You have some bones, and the principle is that you had a monk coming from Bourgogne, arriving in Provence. I don't remember when exactly, but it was in the 8th century or something like that, to take back the skulls of from Provence and to take them back in Bourgogne. He was an official robber, thief. So I say that the skull of Sainte Marie Madeleine in Vézelay and in Provence are based on the same story. There is no confusion. The real other story is the fact that you can find some relics of Sainte Marie Madeleine in Ephesia. I was saying that there is a cave with skulls of her. So it is basically, I believe, and many historians believe that Mary Magdala, Saint John, and the Virgin Mary lived together, or at least founded a community in Ephesia after the crucifixion. Remember, Jesus said to Saint John, "Here is your mother." Showing the Virgin Mary, they founded a community. And I believe that during these years, maybe they have been living during 10 years. Today, if you go to Ephesia, there is the church of the house of the Virgin Mary. Mm-hmm. After having lived there during 10 years, then some people say that the community has been dislocated. I think everyone say the community has been dislocated. Saint John has been exiled to Patmos, to Greece. Virgin Mary was Assumption. She died, if you understand me. And all the disciples, many disciples, but not all, but many disciples went on a boat to Gaul.
There was the two locations. Thanks very much. I know Travis had his hand up, but I'd just like to make a general point. I think first, I think you've made a very good case to resolve some disparate threads in the tradition of Christianity, particularly with the Orthodox and Catholic traditions. But I, as a worshipping pagan, I can see nothing that represents the pagan dispensation. I note no deities of European manifestation, such as Jupiter, being mentioned as being proper objects of worship on a par with Jesus, nor the canon of scripture to be opened up to include works written by Europeans writing of divinity, nor indeed that deity is perhaps to be seen as also manifested in a feminine form, that there are many forms of deity. So yeah, I as a pagan, I couldn't find anything here that connected me with my conception of pagan Rome, even less so with the indigenous traditions of Northern Europe, with Lord Odin, whom I worship. That said, in case people have to go, I don't. Laurent, please, perhaps if you could be brief in response to that, and then we'll attend to other people's questions. Thank you. Could you, if you could stop sharing the screen so we can now all see one another. Thank you.
I suggest, of course, you know, but there are two English writers who developed these ideas. More or less, of course. Mm. But you have Chesterton, Gilbert Keith Chesterton. He explained the connections between Christianity and paganism.
That's not the same. That is not the same. It has connections, but one wants to worship a form of deity given equal importance.
Of course, Jesus. But he enlightens a continuity, which is, for me, the most important point. He enlightens the continuity. He shows that there are very different points. Of course, I do not pretend that Christianism is the same as paganism. You have understood, not at all. Huh? Yeah. And there is this writer who is John Buchan. He has written a novel which is absolutely great, The Dancing Floor. And John Buchan wrote this novel where you have Christians and pagans working together at the end of times to fight evil. It is wonderfully written. It is a great novel with clever assumptions. He was an intellectual also, John Buchan.
Travis, please. Sorry to have kept you waiting. You had a question.
Thank you for your talk, Laurent. I found it very engaging. I don't particularly have an interest in geopolitics or have the knowledge of church history necessary to really engage the history you presented. But I was wondering what you would think about the idea that these principles that produce in history in terms of the Catholic or the Western Church and the Eastern Orthodox Church might have a higher level of reading than just how they present in history or politically. So for example, we could conceptualize the West or the Catholic, certainly given their action across time, as expressing more of the masculine principle. Or the Orthodox Church expressing more of the feminine or mystical principle. When I lived in Russia in 93 and 94, I saw just how spiritually decimated the country was post-Soviet. And I see that true in the West as well during this time, where materialism has, you know, the rationality of that masculine principle, we might say, of the West or of Catholicism, you know, has driven itself into the ground with this radical materialism. And we're now, to my mind, in a kind of state spiritually of dearth that I saw in Moscow in 93 and 94. So to dial this up from the purely political level of history to a spiritual consideration, I think there is much that Orthodoxy and the Eastern mind can bring to Western spirituality. But I think we make a mistake when we embed that in history and empire. I mean, the first Christians and Christ certainly were all apolitical. They lived outside the framework of Rome. And I think the higher order of spiritual wisdom as Christians, as I am a Christian, is to not get embroiled in the mechanisms of lower levels of materiality that express politically also in wars. So I do feel there's much that Russia and the East can offer the West now, and I'm certainly supportive of that, but to create that as something that expresses on a political landscape, and particularly in forms of war, I think misses the spiritual value that it actually has and exchanges it for something paltry instead. What are your thoughts on that?
I absolutely agree on the fact that Catholicism is more or less based on male values, as you say, and orthodoxy on not values, but way of living. And that's the reason why the Christianism from the first ages, which was as Catholic as Orthodox, was it was the perfect equilibrium. And more of this, I said at the beginning of my speech that Catholicism is much turned towards space because its deep will is to be universal, whereas the orthodoxy is more attached to the question of time. The orthodox wants to be permanent in time. And both Catholicism and orthodoxy form a cross, in fact, when you take a look on their relationship. And the French intellectual Raymond Abellio wrote a lot about the relation, and you are absolutely right, the relation between the hierarchy of the one, the stable hierarchy, and the mass fluid vision of orthodoxy, the acephalic vision. Another strong difference is that Catholicism is based on the notion of council.
Sorry, could you repeat that? The notion of
Catholicism is based on the notion of council.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It means that for a Catholic, being Catholic in 2021 means that you understand better Catholicism than being Catholic 1,000 years ago. They think that by adding essay, text, thoughts, dogma, and so on, you understand more and more and more the thoughts of Jesus. And they also think, this is the third point. Second point, in Catholicism world, we think that, I am Catholic also, but we think that the society evolves, and in order to be understood, you have to adapt your teachings, I would say, to the society. On these two points, the Orthodox world is absolutely opposite. In the Orthodox world, they think that the Christians who have understood the best Jesus were the first ones, and that's all. And we every day we lose some persons of the initial Christians. And also the second point.
That made sense what you said. It's coherent.
Mm-hmm. That's the reason why there is a great stability in the Orthodox world. And we can see this stability until, for example, in Russia, until the 15th or even the 16th century. If you take a look on the European artists in the 16th century, for example, or 17th century, nearly all the artists had their fathers, their grandfathers, who were more or less artists also, musicians, writers, sculptors, painters. If you take a look on the first Russian writer, his grandfather was working in the field. He was a peasant. And in fact, you did not have any art in the Orthodox world before the 16th century. I mean, you don't have any, I mean, all the existing arts was subordinated to the church. It was sacerdotal art. You don't have any classical music. You don't have folk music. You don't have architecture outside of the church. You know that in the Western world, you have arts which are not related to the church, profane arts, very early in the Middle Ages or even before. It is not, of course, a critique of Orthodox world. It's just a way to design the real stability of this church. Maybe they're even closer to paganism, I would say, than Catholicism, because paganism...
Yes, I would say that. I was in Estonia and I saw natural religion functioning very closely with Orthodoxy without any problematic.
We can even
a natural religion. Yeah.
We can even say that there is no history of Orthodox Church. Of course, I exaggerate, but there is no. You have no Qatar in Orthodox history. You have no Protestantism. You have no great heresy, just like this. It purely does not exist.
Only within Orthodoxy.
Only?
Only within Orthodoxy.
Yes.
The heresies.
But this is, yes, yes. And so Dostoevsky is not right when he says that, it's a difficult question, but when Dostoevsky says that Western world is falling apart because of the church, of course, it is not because of the church. It is because of the lack of church, of course. But Dostoevsky says that from the beginning, and it is also the idea of Alexander Dugin, it is the idea basically of many, of all the Orthodox. They simply think that if Western world is falling apart, it is due to the weakness of the Catholic Church. And they say that the Catholic Church is intrinsically weak because it's a church which needs always to discuss, to add something, to add, to do some counsel. And they say that from the beginning, there is a problem. And the beginning for them is the creation of the papal states.
I hear what you're saying, but you could argue that all of Orthodoxy was weak if we look at the Soviet states that were Orthodox. Right. And we have now. Right. So it's I would just say that we have cycles of history, and to grasp too tightly onto history as opposed to functioning at the higher spiritual levels is to really miss the patterns or even the, you know, the repetitions and cycles of history. You know, Orthodoxy was depleted when I was in Russia. Now America is depleted by materialism, neoliberalism. So these cycles. I think you would be mistaken not to incorporate the Soviet period into Orthodoxy's story.
Yeah, but I don't think that I went also many times in Russia, but from 2007, I don't know before, but I think that Orthodox was not depleted in Russia even under Stalin era, as Catholicism was depleted in Europe under democracy, I would say, cannot be comparable.
Yes, I think we.
Thank you for your answer. Yeah, I appreciate it.
But, yeah, get something more people. Mehran, please have a.
Thank you for a nice presentation, and maybe it raised more questions that it answered. But that's great, and yeah, I hope we can have more further discussions about, you know, the reemergence of the Roman Empire, which necessarily doesn't have to do anything with the Roman Catholic Church. And yeah, I mean that the Catholic Church had the aspiration to take over the Roman. They did it in 1,000 years. It has their some kind of, you know, Reich, 1,000 years of dominance, and it has its time. I'm not sure that it will be the part of future. Maybe I can give you some, give this Catholicism a credit, and it's, you know, having regarding life as sacred. I mean, you know, when we're talking about Northern Europe, it's about abortion, free sex, pornography, Sweden, you know, Swedish movie. And then you have Italy and all that conservatism. And I cannot see any future in Roman Catholic conservatism, no, and neither in the Russian traditionalism. Maybe they can be brought into some kind of struggle.
Yes.
I would say, I would connect the future to what Nietzsche calls the will to power.
Yeah.
And I agree with Steve about, you know, what about Northern Europe? What about, you know, the Nordics? What about the Anglo-Saxons? Those who are the leading forces of the Industrial Revolution. That is the huge force behind the power and the power creating force. And, you know, one can talk about transhumanism, what's going on, the Rothschilds, the, you know, Vatican Church, the globalists. And, you know, you have this Judeo-Christian will to power establishment. They got the banks, they got the, you know, power, but they are also, they are very afraid of the emerging power. Who are they? You know, you mentioned Bernard Henri Levy. Who is his main adversary? It's Iran. You know, this integration of Iran is the whole project of this global, you know, activists. And I talked with an Iranian historian, and he's totally against Islam, totally against Christianity, but not that against Israel. But, you know, his point was that Putin is a national socialist. Boris Johnson also, Trump. And then you have also, you know, the Chinese leader, and also Modi in India. He see a lot of national socialists. That has nothing to do with Hitler and the Reich. But then he's talking about, you know, the global powers like Germany, like France, like Sweden, and so on. And then I can come to a point about, you know, France and the very crucial role France plays and will play. And one is, you know, you never mentioned Napoleon. You never mentioned, you know, Bonapartism. You never mentioned, you know, the rise of French Empire and, you know, dismantling this holy German, you know, Austrian, Hungary, you know, you are not holy anymore. You know, they just, you know, completely demolished the holiness of this German. But my point is that maybe the third, maybe we should more talk about the notion of Antichrist when we're talking about, you know, the future of Europe and not Christianity. And then I can, you know, have some kind of synthesis, Hegelian, you know, approach to the future of Europe, the dialectics. And what about, you know, the book of Revelation, the harlot of Babylon? Where is Babylon? Babylon is Iran. You know, the Iranians are talking about, we will conquer Baghdad, we will conquer Damascus, we will conquer Beirut, and all the way to the Spain again. And who is talking about that? That's great. But only Americans and Israelis are talking about the Iranian danger. And okay, it's just a, you know, very exclusive club. Okay. And you have, you know, the Syrian world war going on, Russians invited by Iranians into the Syria, back to the Mediterranean. And then you can talk about, you know, a new Roman Empire. But Russians will not be the major player. So let's talk about, you know, the harlot of Babylon, the, you know, the prince of darkness and the return of the beast, which is Nero. My point is that why not going back to track and using the Christian heritage?
Thank
and
you.
What is left so that we can go on. And then we can talk about paganism and the Third Roman Empire, not necessarily about Catholicism and what we can do with the past. They are not a part of future, sorry to say.
Thank you.
Fatima, also Ismailians, you were also into this esoteric about, you know, a third Persian empire in Egypt, which is my very, you know, dream. You know, the return of Ismailians, which are I was in talk with you know, very cultural knowing people. They talked about very interesting aspect. Pardon to taking your time. They said, they told me that there's only two cultures which are extremely esoteric, and the reason behind their downfall was that their secret societies collapsed. It was the Vikings and it was the Ismailians, you know, Hassan Sabah and those who created all these nation of secret society, empire, Silk Road, and brotherhood that the French took after. That is the case. Thank you.
Speaking to, because other people wanting to speak.
But I had something important to say. Okay. That was important. Everything of that was important. Thank you.
Thank you.
I can just say two things. Of course, there is no specific questions, but concerning the Prince of Darkness, I specifically talked about the Empire of Non-Being established since 1945. So I think it is exactly the same thing, the Empire of Non-Being. And considering, I fully agree with you, considering the expression, the will to power. Of course, it is maybe the central question. I finished my talk by saying that the concept of Third Rome was not only political, but it was theological. Why? Because if you remember, some sentences of the first fathers of church, such as Saint Irenee de Lyon or even Saint Denis Areopagite, many others, they said about the mission of Jesus, God became man so that man might become God. And this second part of the sentence is negligible, is very often forgotten. So that man might become God. Our salvation is only possible through our deification. It is even, of course, written in the book of John. I said, you are gods. Jesus said this to his disciples. What does it mean? It means that this concept of deification through the Holy Spirit, of course, is the only concept which can at the end defeat the empire of non-being. And this concept goes beyond Christianism. That is what I strongly think.
May I add something? I want to confirm your thesis. What Zizek says about the Holy Spirit as the community of believers. That is also something that I strongly believe in. Thank you.
Yeah. Let's go to Andrew, and then I'll be asking people who haven't spoken for a comment, Vladimir, AJ, Michael, Catherine, and Mick. So yeah, and Andrew, please, hello, good to
hello.
Have you. Please.
Yeah, hello, Laurent. Yes, well, I will speak English, try to be clear as far as I can. Yes, Laurent, you just mentioned the question of the Protestantism, the reform. Yes, I just want to underline one point, and I want to be short. As you know, the Catholicism always absorbed. Their strategy was to absorb the ancient beliefs or even the heresy. That was their way to fight. And not always to fight in front of, but to absorb. And they did that for the paganism, because as you know, the saints we are in our calendars, they most of the time they cover, they represent an ancient god that was absorbed and baptized as a saint. Anyway, so that's the old way to strategy of the Catholic. And for the Protestants, the reform, when the reform grew up in Germany 500 years ago, with and in Genova with Calvin, and in Thuringen with Luther, then they also adopt the same things. They absorb part of the Protestantism. In such a way that I think one of the main differences there is between Orthodoxy and Catholicism is that in some ways the Catholic, they are somehow very, very Protestant, especially from the eyes of the Orthodox. They are very Protestant in many ways, even if we don't realize. Laurent, as me, we are from the same city, from Lyon, and most of, more or less, we have the same way of thinking. We are both baptized as a Catholic, but maybe we do not realize as Protestant we are also, because the Church absorbs many things. For example, the Catechism. That was a strategy for the Church in order to fight the reform, that they said we will do the same as them. Then they cannot tell anymore than we don't want to make the people to participate, then we will invent things. Like, for example, the reading, you know, in the Catholic Mass, mm-hmm. someone from the people can they ask to come to the altar and to read a piece of the text. That's also very Protestant. And there is many things, like, for example, the chairs. You know, if there is chairs in the church, in the Catholic Church, and not in the Orthodoxy, it's because of the Protestant, because we have to sit down and to read. So if you want to read, you have to sit down, you know. So it's sometimes things are very concrete. And so I just come to this point that Laurent, you made a very interesting and somehow very high level conference today. But I think, and I finish with that, in order to balance it with something very more concrete, I believe we cannot make this unity of Russia and Europe and UK. Only by religion, because there will be always theological fightings. But we just have to underline something which is very concrete, and we don't even realize that these things is that we share the same ground, the floor, the ground, the same continent, you know. And when I was by bicycle crossing Europe and Russia, and when I there's only a border, but that's a human border. The same ground, so we share the same ground. And I think if we, if you are agree, Laurent, we can just think about these two levels. They work together. The very concrete things is that we share the same continent. Well, for UK, I know it's an island, and that's very important. But still, we are very much closer than United States, you know. And so so if we can just think, remind one thing, this connection between the very concrete and the very spiritual, there is no contradiction. That is what only the things I wanted to add today.
Thanks very much. Thank you. I thought, yeah, it's more of a comment than a question. Thanks. Vladimir, I mean, you're someone that is very familiar with orthodoxy and the territory over which Laurent has traversed. What are your thoughts? I'm sure you have some.
Yes, what would I like to add? First of all, to me, the Roman Empire is, the first of all, that's the area of Roman law. That's just the fact. And what is this area of Roman law nowadays? So we have some European countries, some also Russia and some other Eurasian countries, even Japan formally. But and Latin America. But basically, we have in the Roman law, we have like two basic like areas. The Roman Germanic law ruling in Western Europe, Roman law, and then the Russian law. The Russian law is also the part of Roman law, and in the Western Europe. So we have, but in excluding United Kingdom, because we have a common law in England, and but yes, basically in England. But in Western Europe, Western European or Germanic, Roman Germanic tradition, they have mostly the aspect of civil law, civil Roman law. But in Russia, they have not so much from civil Roman law, but they have from the Roman public law in terms of politics. And but comically, both aspects were originated in the second Rome, not in the first one. I mean, this Western Rome, not in the third one like Moscow, but in the second Rome in the Byzantine. Laws of Emperor Justinian, it was just the classical reduction of Roman law. And then it was studied in Western Europe, starting from Bologna University, and then it was spread out in Western Europe. But also the Russians tried also to use this the Roman law, but not, as I said, mostly political. In terms of emperor, the monarchy, and how to rule the country, and not very much in terms of civil or let's say the criminal law, because the criminal law in the whole Europe mostly is coming from the northern law, which is very close to the English common law. But coming back to Roman Empire, so for me, this Roman Empire is exactly this reunification of the areas of Roman law. Because if there is no Roman law, no Rome at all, because the law was the religion of Rome. Because what is the Roman religion? It's not like Jupiter, it's not like Venus or nothing like that. It's just a fairy tales. The Roman religion was a law.
That. You can't say that, Vladimir. You can't.
Yes,
say
I can. Because the Roman sacerdotes, those who rule the law, they were sacerdotes, they priests, and they were the lawyers. And even Pontific Maximus, the Roman Pope, he still hold this title of the Roman this Roman title. And then the Pontific Maximus was the head of Roman jurists, lawyers. basically. And then so the Roman law was sacred. That's why this, then big, but it's like a special point to understand the sacred part of Roman law, to understand the Roman law as a religion. And that's a very specific point. And then if you go inside this this discourse, you will understand where from we all have the sacred empire and this, and that all these titles in the Byzantines and also in the Western Rome, they were they have the sacred functions as well. And in especially in Byzantium, the politics was not just action, it was also like a liturgy, it was a sacred action as well. And then and different politicians, like in Moscow, in Russia, or even the Mussolini, he spoke about the third law. And there were some other receptions of Byzantium, of Roman law. So according to my opinion, exactly the Roman Empire means I coming back to the Roman law and the sacred point of the Roman law, to understand the Rome as a sacred, not just a religion, but exactly the Roman religion is a Roman law. That's the point to me. And then I guess if you understand, if you get this point, if you understand this this discourse, then you can understand what is the, basically the power of Rome and why we do not have it now. But
yeah, no, that's a very good point, Vladimir. I mean, we've been going well over 2.5 hours. So I think we need to really think about heading towards the end. So Laurent, please, I mean, respond, but please not.
No, I agree. I said at the beginning of my speech that the religion of Rome was the administration, and that the church heritated from the administration framework of Rome. But of course, you have you had also, if you go to the border between at the western part of Newcastle, you will see some temples of Mitra. So the Mitra religion was very, very present in the soldiers and so on. But I think that the administration was maybe just like in China. In China, the religion is the administration. Maybe it was more or less the same kind.
Yes, and, absolutely.
I think one thing is that I would agree with Vladimir, and I think perhaps you, Lauren, that there wasn't this distinction between the state and religion that yes. we have. The state was seen as an embodiment of the will of the gods, in a sense, and that I like as an idea. Michael, do you have, I'm sure you've got some things flying around.
Yes, I do, but I think that the discussion covers so many points that it's almost impossible to know which one to choose and to follow up. I'll just pick one out that strikes me. I don't entirely agree with what I understood as your wish to sort of merge Nietzsche and Dostoevsky into some corporate idea of a will to power of a third Rome, because they seem to me about as diametrically opposite as it could possibly be for two thinkers. In fact, much more, I think, is Dostoevsky the polar opposite of Nietzsche than Marx was. Because Dostoevsky in his novels, as far as I understand them, and I think I've read them all, is pleading with heart and soul against the will to power. Everything Alyosha is against the will to power. The will to power as conceived in the Brothers Karamazov, when Christ returns and the heretics are burned in front of the holy prelates, and the Grand Inquisitor orders Christ to be seized and thrown into prison. Whereas Nietzsche rejoiced that the Borgias sat in the sea of, oh, you remember in, I think it was Beyond Good and Evil, that he says, oh, joy to see the Borgias in the Holy See. What wonderful to see the weak effete Christianity overturned by the true pagan will to power of the Borgias. That's one point. The other thing, I don't entirely share your dismissal of nationalism, because for all its faults and everything that's gone wrong with nationalism, nationalism at least keeps its attachment to the place that you're born to. And imperialism has the tradition of being in some ways always cosmopolitan, in the sense that it yearns to create a universal man that has obeisance to this imperialistic idea, whether it's Rome or the British Empire or whatever else it is. That's an extremely difficult subject, by the way, so you really can't talk about it now, but I think it's a much more complex subject perhaps than you allowed it to be, or you were making your point, and that's perfectly absolutely legitimate for you to do. But I do think that nationalism, there's much more to it than that. And just take the example of Ukraine to finish with. I mean, for all they might be a bit batty at the edges, the Ukrainian nationalists, but there is deep resentment against the what Stalin did to the Ukraine the name of a nationalism fused with imperialism, which is, of course, one of the most tyrannical things you can have on the earth. And that is what very often happens, of course, obviously happened with the Third Reich, which is a sort of combination of empire and nation. But as I say, the subject is too complicated to could talk all night about it. But those were the sort of points that I would feel strongly about.
Thanks for that light you cast on a few of the points, Michael, very eloquently. Before I ask...
May I have a final point?
No,
very small.
I must say, I want to...
It's in praise of Laurent. Just one.
Please, we must have some decor. I'm going to be asking... Yes,
but I have to tell him that. Well, that is
no,
the holy people of France and that connection to Palestine. It was the main point in this story. Thank you.
Yeah, we must be...
He had a great point here.
Lauren, if it's anything to add to Michael's comments.
Yes. Thank you for your comments. You have a feeling concerning the novels of Dostoevsky. You are fully right. Dostoevsky is not... there is no ideology in the novels of Dostoevsky. That's the reason why all the sentences I have read are not at all extracted from the novels. They are extracted from his diaries. They reflect his ideas. You will see the desire of all of us for union with all the European races in the nature of our relations with them, in the character of our state policy. So there is a clear will of power in the idea of Dostoevsky, which is not expressed in the novels, which is not at all expressed in the novel, because he's a real writer, and in his novels, he shows the complexity of the world, and he shows that the will of power is a proof of weakness. But from his political point of view, he really wanted to show that religiously, but also politically, Europe could be saved by Russia, but from an eschatological point of view. About the imperialism, this idea of conflict between imperialism and nationalism today is... I am deeply convinced, deeply, but deeply convinced, that the idea of unification of Europe, of the real Europe, will finally emerge in all the spirits. And there is no connection between imperialism and cosmopolitism. The cosmopolitism emerged in the Western world just after the First World War, when all the empires were extincted, were died. That's all. From an historical point of view, it is the emergence of nations which impose the cosmopolitism. At least in Europe, it's clearly visible. Before 1914, you had maybe 30 countries in the world. After 1918, you had 150 countries in the world. it's the beginning of nationalism is analogically a kind of individualism at a country point of view. Okay, and then from Ukraine, of course, I do not agree. I know many. I know Moldova, for example. I am friend with Yuri Eroska. Yuri Eroska is a great politician in Moldova. He fought during. He had many strong battles during 20 years against Bolshevism, against Bolshevik Russia. And he finally won, he and his friends. And he became, how you say, he was the leader of the Assembly of Moldavia. And after having battled against Stalin, Bolshevism, of course, he then fought against the Western world because he found that this ideology was at least as bad as a Bolshevik ideology. Not in the same way, of course. So the Ukrainian, the Western part of Ukraine, do not fight against Stalin. This is absolutely false. They do not fight against Stalin. They do fight for liberalism. And they fight against the eastern part of their country, which speaks Russia. Stalin is totally dead. Maybe you know that 5 years ago in Sweden, I had some friends who lived in Sweden. They received letters. Each inhabitants of Stockholm received a letter explaining a letter from the government explaining what to do in case of an attack by Russia. I mean that you have many governments from the eastern part of Europe who maintains the fear of Russia in their population, artificially, of course. And this is this is why Ukraine is in war. And don't forget also that there is a very important reason of the war in Ukraine, which we never speak about. It is also a racial war. It is a racial war, since the Western Ukrainians consider themselves as pure Slav, pure Slavic people, and they consider Slav who speak Russian as a mixture of Russian, Tatar, and so on. So it is a very important cause of the war, which is, of course, totally blacklisted in Western world. We never hear of this. But I can tell you that this is very important for them.
Right. Thanks. Obviously, it's a big...
It's a big topic.
Yes, yeah, so many big topics. I think Catherine's gone, unfortunately. Oh, Mick... please unmute my friend so we can hear you.
Right. Well, it's good to see you again, Laurent. Since the conference we did in London.
Okay.
Yeah. But I mean, it was an absolutely excellent lecture. But it was just so comprehensive. I wouldn't know really where to start in terms of commenting on it. But I enjoyed it very much. I thought it was very informative. And thanks for giving it. That's all I've got to say, really.
I think that seems
a very good conclusion.
Nice note on which we should all head towards our dinner tables and seek some refreshment. Yeah, Lauren, thanks very much. I appreciate all the work you went in to preparing it. And I think... orthodoxy is, just on a fine note, is one of the most pagan forms of Christianity, in that they give importance to the seeing the divine in the image, in the icon, which very much goes against the commandments in the Bible. And it seems very localized. Each place has its own expression, its own style of dress, and that does seem very, very rooted. It seems the form of Christianity that could well accept, although that I kind of it wouldn't do, the native deities. But anyway, that's a big issue. But let's all leave on this with the feeling of thankfulness for this evening. I'll just say a few words in Old Norse, and then we can blow out the candle and say our goodbyes. Om altugir muskun sani azir at kveld skal dagløyfa. Kono eprende maki erunde e moye givine iste ive kumur ulletrukit e ut not skal hund løyfa. Blessed gods of our peoples and lands, at evening shall one praise the day, and at night shall one praise the evening. We offer thanks for what we've profited by and for what we found pleasure in. Sigur either, sigur either, sigur os, frido either, frido either, frido os. Thanks again, everyone, for staying with it. And thanks, Andrew, for your contribution. Good to see you. Thanks very much, Vladimir. Thanks, Michael, in London, Germany. Thanks, Mick. Thanks, Mehran. And thanks you, most of all, Laurent, for the work.
Yeah, great show.
Take care, everyone. Yes, bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks.
Yes, bye.